Nothing says America like our first two stories today, which involve someone intentionally crashing a plane for clout and a seemingly harmless company selling a drink that could kill you.
Hell yeah. USA! USA! I want the lemonade that kills you!
And that's not all, because we also have updates on some of our dumbest criminals that our country has to offer. Jacob Wall and Martin Shkreli.
What year is it? 2017?
It's obviously a little bit strange that we're naturally getting a bunch of these loose ends all tied up as the actual year itself comes to a close, but we will embrace this kind of serendipity whenever we can find it. So let's start out with an update on what some could argue was clout chasing on a level we'd never even seen before, and an activity which is now sending the influencer involved straight to prison.
Oh, so pranks are illegal now?
I guess so.
We can't do pranks with airplanes? That's the message the universe is sending me.
I guess.
These past few months. You can't do airplane pranks. It's illegal. And risk the lives of other people.
And potentially burning down acres and acres and acres.
Oh, now it's illegal to burn down a forest.
I miss the old America.
God. So yeah, as a nice bonus to all the coverage regarding this case, is that despite being an Olympic athlete, Trevor Jacob is now consistently referred to as a YouTube prankster when he's mentioned in the press, which might be the harshest punishment of all.
No, you don't understand. I competed in Sochi. Sure you did, YouTuber.
Yeah, just all of his accomplishments reduced to dust.
Mm-hmm.
No, you're the YouTube prankster, the one who thought crashing a plane was a prank.
And a good one at that.
So in case you need a quick refresh, just over 2 years ago, YouTube prankster Trevor Jacob intentionally crashed a small plane over Central California while filming the entire thing as a publicity stunt for his channel, I guess. In the original video, Jacob was claiming that, oh no, the engine malfunctioned and that caused the plane to start falling from the sky. Oh my God. Am I, Trevor Jacob, YouTube prankster, going to die?
Well, luckily, I've been wearing this parachute the entire time.
So yeah, he just ditched the plane and parachuted safely to the ground. Whew. Not only did he not die, but wow. Once I get to that crash site and
get all those GoPros,
get those memory cards, well, that's content, baby.
Uh-huh.
So viewers, pilots, journalists, and pretty much everyone else, they were immediately a bit skeptical of Trevor Jacob's claims. YouTube prankster Trevor Jacob.
Yeah.
But the most obvious thing that stood out was, yeah, the fact that he was wearing a fucking parachute for the entire video. That's just not something pilots do.
No. Especially like wearing it during takeoff.
Yeah, that's...
Like, I could almost maybe see someone having one in the small plane as a backup. Even that would be abnormal, but
yeah.
Wearing it from the second you take off and then being like, oh, geez, oh, the engine went out.
It's just not something, like, I mean...
Pilots immediately were like, this doesn't happen.
Right, because... When plane crashes happen, especially for planes that size, you're usually too close to the ground for any sort of parachuting situation to work, unless, of course, you're wearing a parachute the entire time and ready to rip that cord.
Yeah. Well, after he landed safely on the ground, while filming himself the entire time with GoPros and a selfie stick, obvious.
Thank God we got the footage.
Trevor Jacob hiked to safety after being spotted by locals. Shortly after that, and thanks to the help of someone with a helicopter, he located his crashed plane, towed the wreckage to a hangar at the airport that he had initially taken off from, recovered the footage of the crash from the GoPros that he'd attached to the plane, and then went about dismantling the wreckage before lying to the FAA about all of these activities in order to hinder their investigation.
Well, I was done with the plane.
What?
Why would anyone need to look at the plane?
Illegal to destroy evidence?
I'm recycling, buddy.
Not just destroy evidence, but hide it.
Yeah. Pretty suspicious.
Meanwhile, his video racked up millions of views and massive amounts of criticism and accusations. And the last update we had on this guy was earlier this year when he admitted that, he did intentionally crash the plane in order to drive a ton of traffic to his YouTube channel. Is that a crime? Oh, we're getting word that it is. Shit.
So yeah, not only was that a crime, but so was the cover-up.
Mm-hmm.
From the LA Times, back in May, the pilot, Trevor Jacob, agreed to plead guilty Thursday to a felony charge of obstructing a federal investigation by deliberately destroying the wreckage of an airplane that he intentionally crashed in Santa Barbara County to gain online views, according to the U.S. Attorney's Office, Central District of California. I love that the official verdict. He did it for views.
Literally clout chasing.
Sir, we find you guilty of clout chasing.
Yeah.
According to the FAA, the plane crash was intentional and there was plenty of evidence to prove it. Jacobs installed cameras on the plane prior to flight, including one pointed at the propeller. He flew with a parachute on. He opened the pilot door before claiming the engine had failed. Come on, Trevor! He did not attempt to restart the engine, contact air traffic control, or find a safe place to land. Well, I guess the plane's going down. Good thing I'm wearing this parachute.
I'm not going to take any of the other steps that are trained to me, but I'm just going to jump out.
I guess that's it.
Yeah.
We're going down. The plea agreement states that in the weeks that followed, Jacob lied to investigators that he did not know the wreckage's location, when in fact he and a friend had towed the wreckage using a helicopter to Rancho Sisquoc, then placed it in Jacob's pickup truck and took it to a hangar at Lompoc City Airport. 2 days after the doomed flight, on November 26, 2021, the National Transportation Safety Board began its investigation, according to the Justice Department. The FAA followed suit 3 days later. Jacob admits in the agreement that he then cut up and destroyed the airplane wreckage, then deposited the detached parts of the wrecked airplane into trash bins at the airport and elsewhere with the intent of obstructing the federal investigations. This is like when you murder someone and you cut up their body and like stash their different parts in different dumpsters the city.
But if you did that at the location where it all started,
yeah,
where it's easily, like anyone...
So many steps here where he just didn't really think it all the way through.
Just like a mechanic working at this airport, like, huh, weird, there's a bunch of plane parts shoved into garbage cans around
here. This is an airport.
Probably nothing. So yeah, Trevor Jacob is now being sentenced, or he has now been sentenced for his crimes. And despite seeming like a pretty light sentence overall, it's certainly not nothing. And the fact that he's going behind bars in federal prison is actually surprising. Plus, like we said, he has the scarlet letter of being a YouTuber attached to him forever.
Yeah, first day he walks into prison, everyone's banging on the bars. Oh, we got a prankster here!
We got a YouTuber!
Prankster! Oh, hello, prankster!
Clout's not gonna pay the bills here in prison, bub. Anyways, here's the update from LA Times' most recent reporting. An Olympic snowboarder, come on, LA Times, who deliberately crashed his single-propeller plane on a flight from Lompoc to Mammoth Lakes to gain viewers for his YouTube channel, was sentenced to 6 months in federal prison for obstruction of justice. Trevor Jacob, 30, of Lompoc, pleaded guilty to one count of destruction and concealment with the intent to obstruct a federal investigation on June 30th. Admitting to destroying the wreckage of an airplane he intentionally crashed as a stunt to bolster his social media profile, according to the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Central District of California.
Your Honor, this man did it for clout.
Yep. Jun Jun. It appears that Jacob exercised exceptionally poor judgment in committing this offense, prosecutors argued in a sentencing memorandum.
It does appear that way, yes. Yeah.
Jacob most likely committed this offense to generate social media and news coverage for himself and to obtain financial gain. Nevertheless, this type of daredevil conduct cannot be tolerated. I like how they almost pitched it as like, look, okay, this was pretty cool.
It was pretty cool.
We
what
can
a
all
video.
Agree that it was cool, and he did succeed in getting the coverage, but we can't tolerate it.
When he gets out, is he going to be, they got to take away his flight privileges, right?
No, he should get into a plane and wave at everyone as he leaves the prison, and then he should attempt to fly over the Pacific Ocean in a single-engine Cessna.
Yeah, doing what no one has ever done since Amelia Earhart tried it over 100 years ago.
Yeah.
But no, really, are they going to let him fly again?
I don't think so. I don't think so, Ellie.
Yeah, I feel like this is like, this is a, you lose your license sort of situation.
You would hope. 6 months in federal prison for intentionally crashing a plane and then hiding all the evidence of that. At least it's something. And like we said back when this happened, he is actually very lucky that he didn't accidentally set half the state on fire with this stupid stunt.
Yeah, not a place you want to be
this was
lighting fires.
During one of the worst drought years.
Which is every year.
Well, except for this year.
Yeah, actually, this year, not bad.
Mm-hmm.
But
things could have gone a lot worse.
You should have waited until 2023, when we weren't in a drought year.
Everyone would have clapped.
Hey, where's the harm?
What's the worst that could happen? I think it's pretty cool that he crashed his plane and then hit all the evidence.
Hey, listen, he might have done it on purpose, but that video, like, I was on the edge of my seat.
Yeah.
I thought I was about to watch a man die. But lo and behold, he's got that parachute already on.
Luckily, he was wearing that parachute the entire time.
He's already got the door halfway open the second the engine cuts.
The funny thing, too, is like watching the video back and like seeing how uncomfortable it is for him to lean forward and fly that thing because he's wearing a fucking parachute. It's just no one does that.
Trevor, you didn't think this one through.
He did think it through. He thought about all the views he was going to get.
His judgment was clouded by clout.
Mm-hmm.
Clouted. But moving on from people being punished for good reason to people being handed a death sentence for simply wanting to enjoy a cold, refreshing, fruity drink down at their local fast casual chain restaurant where they got salads, they got soups,
they
got sandwiches, and they got the lemonade that fucking kills you. Panera Bread. Now, this story initially popped up a few weeks ago. And let's get one thing straight really quick. This is, it's a tragedy. People have actually died. No one is laughing at them. It's fucked up. Like, these people should still be alive.
Yes.
And yeah, we and others online simply find it just insane that a major restaurant chain was not only serving a lemonade that kills people, but in spite of all of the negative press, including the most recent tragedy, turns out, I guess they're still serving the lemonade that kills people. All they've done is add a little sign to it that provides a warning to customers. Warning, yeah. This is the lemonade that kills people.
Just letting everyone know.
Just a heads up.
Uh-huh.
So now that the story has gone viral, people are posting images and clips on social media that claim to show them consuming, them consuming the drink as a dare. Similar to the Grimace Shake Challenge from earlier this year, except this drink actually does have a body count.
Yeah.
We were all goofing around with the Grimace Shake.
Yeah, meanwhile, the charged lemonade was right there actually killing people.
Yeah, this drink kills people, and like, not magically, it kills them through some very basic chemistry that it is shocking that this national restaurant chain looked at that and said, no, sounds good.
Let's keep it.
Let's put that in the section where you get unlimited refills.
Yeah, not even where you get them. It was included originally. This was one of the things that changed, but it was originally included on the all-you-can-drink menu.
Oh, my God.
Come get as many charged lemonades as you can handle. How tough are you?
This shit's, like, so wild to me because, like, I've always been a caffeine fiend ever since I was way too young to be drinking coffee, to be honest. But it's always just been regular home-brewed coffee.
Yeah.
Once all this energy drink shit started happening, I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? Are you insane?
People
like, no, I don't drink coffee. I just drink like 3 tall cans of Monster every day.
People are insane about that kind of stuff, but also the idea that you're like just sipping on a lemonade, it is very clearly something that you do not think will affect you as much as one of those large energy drinks that tastes toxic.
Yeah,
it tastes like what it's supposed to be. It doesn't taste good for you or anything like that.
Yeah, like having the bubbles in like a Red Bull, it slows you down. You literally can't chug it.
It's also a very unique taste where you're like, I'm drinking this for the purpose of being
It's not
energized.
Bad, but clearly you're like, oh, this is...
It's like medicine. This is doing something.
It's like how people develop, they develop a taste for like nose drugs.
Yeah.
Like, it's not a good taste, but...
No. You get used to it.
You associate it with good times.
The other problem here is that, like, outside of this being overly caffeinated, it's a horrible drink in general because it's, if any Europeans are watching, this is not your standard lemonade.
No, sir.
This is water and sugar.
Yeah.
It's not exactly a fruit drink by any stretch of the imagination other than there is fruit taste. I would say comparatively, small compared to the sugar and caffeine.
I would assume at some point in the very long like chemical supply chain that went into this, there are real lemons grown on a real tree. But
we've included citric acid for that lemony taste. Oh, yeah. Anyways, the drinks in question are the Panera Charged lemonades, which have absurd levels of caffeine in them. Up to 3 times more in one serving than a 12-ounce can of Red Bull, to be precise.
That's insane, too, because
three Red Bulls in one.
The regular Red Bull is 8 ounces.
Yeah.
And that one, like, I only get those when I'm, like, really, real fucking tired, and, like, I just know that I got to stay up for something.
Yeah.
I get the sugar-free 8-ounce one.
Yeah, I was going to say, I get the sugar-free one.
Yeah, the sugar-free 8-ounce Red Bull, the tiniest Red Bull. And after drinking that, I'm, like, good to go for, like, 6 hours.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah. So you're getting this in a gigantic drink where you don't think about how much you're drinking.
Yeah, we're talking, again, for Europeans, when you get a cup at a restaurant...
Massive!
...that you can take to the soda fountain, we're not talking a cup like you know it.
Yeah.
We're talking a large bucket-like receptacle.
Yeah.
32 ounces. I don't know what that is in liters, but it's more than 1 liter for sure.
Yeah. If that wasn't ridiculous enough, the charged lemonades were also, as I mentioned earlier, part of a company-wide all-you-can-drink promotion at one point.
No!
And we're not sure about you, but if we were a customer at Panera, I simply wouldn't immediately assume that their lemonade products were filled to the brim with caffeine.
That's just it. It's heavily caffeinated lemonade is just not a thing. It's not a concept anyone is familiar with.
Nor would anyone be familiar enough, the average person be familiar enough with if you were looking at a caffeinated lemonade, to understand just how much caffeine they were putting into it.
Like this,
or how much is bad
yeah.
versus how much is good. Because no one knows. I don't know the amount of milligrams that
right.
is dangerous
versus
not. You
gotta do like the equivalents of cups of coffee or whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, this makes, it's like, no one would expect this in lemonade just as much as they wouldn't expect a caffeinated fucking French onion soup.
No, yeah. So the signs, there were signs on the lemonade dispensers that indicated—
Did they have a skull and crossbones?
No, but they pretty much do now with the new sign that's out there. But anyways, the original signs they on the lemonade dispensers, they did indicate the inclusion of caffeine. But again, you're relying on the average customer understanding how many milligrams of caffeine is overdoing it. The original Death by Lemonade case hit the press in late October after a 21-year-old University of Pennsylvania student named Sarah Katz suffered cardiac arrest and died hours after consuming the charged lemonade. And here's NBC News from a few weeks back.
An Ivy League student with a heart condition died after she drank Panera Bread's charged lemonade, a large cup of which contains more caffeine than cans of Red Bull and Monster Energy drinks combined, according to a lawsuit. Katz had a heart condition called long QT syndrome type 1 and avoided energy drinks at the recommendation of her doctors, according to the filing. Katz bought a charged lemonade from a Panera Bread restaurant in Philadelphia on September 10, 2022, according to the suit. She went into cardiac arrest hours later, said her roommate and close friend, Victoria Rose Conroy. Quote, "She was very, very vigilant about what she needed to do to keep herself safe," Conroy said. "I guarantee, if Sarah had known how much caffeine this was, she never would have touched it with a 10-foot pole." The charged lemonade was offered side-by-side with all of Panera's non-caffeinated and or less caffeinated drinks, and was advertised as a plant-based and clean beverage that contained as much caffeine as the restaurant's dark roast coffee, according to photos of both the menu and beverage dispensers in the store, which were included in the wrongful death lawsuit. But at 390 milligrams, the large charged lemonade has more caffeine than any size of Panera's dark roast coffee, the complaint says. Numbers that the nutrition facts on Panera's website confirm. It also has guarana extract, another stimulant, as well as the equivalent of nearly 30 teaspoons of sugar. From sea to shining sea. Is it even sugar, though?
It's probably corn syrup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
High fructose corn syrup. This is also wild because, like, even before I became a lifelong caffeine addict, like, one of my favorite drinks as a kid was lemonade when you go to the restaurant and stuff. So there has definitely been, like, 9-year-olds just
mistakenly
pounding
this
shit.
Or their parents getting it by mistake or doing it intentionally.
Which is bad for them and also bad for their parents.
Yeah.
Who were hoping that eating a big, big sandwich would tire that kid out.
Nope. Unlimited energy. Well, this week, a second lawsuit hit the company, sparking a wave of social media mockery and a worrisome amount of people who seem more curious than ever to try the lemonade that kills you.
This is so stupid because, like even if you don't die, most people won't. But having too much caffeine in your bloodstream is just so unpleasant.
They're going to have
anxiety
disorders.
Yeah.
They're going to have extra stress on their heart. You're going to get worked up, potentially have panic attacks.
Yeah, you're going to feel like shit for like the rest of the day.
Also, just drinking a sugary drink this large in general, like I'm not trying to tell you to, like I'm not trying to be a nutritionist or anything like that. It's just bad. It's not great, and you don't realize what you're consuming because it's liquid calories and it's not great.
It is super weird that people just
it's just sugar water.
With every meal, drink sugar water.
Yeah.
And look, I'm not hating. I have a.
Was it Bloomberg that tried to stop this in New York?
Yeah, yeah.
Where he's like, look, but 64 also, ounces of Coca-Cola is not good for you.
You do have to remember that at the time, 7-Eleven was selling a literal bucket.
Yeah, like this fucking big.
Yeah.
And people would just consume that all day long.
I don't think, the nanny state thing, I don't know, whatever. But like, it's just.
It wouldn't be an issue if people could take care of themselves.
It is wild that people drink sugary drinks like with every meal, just like throughout the day. Like I've luckily never been into that. Like the second, like I started realizing that you can get fat, I was like, what are easy ways to avoid that?
Stop
just like don't
drinks.
Have fucking Pepsi that's, with every meal.
Yeah, well, that it used to be like a dessert item, and that's why when you look at like old Coca-Cola bottles from like decades ago, they're all 8 ounces.
Yeah,
it was supposed to be a treat.
They sell them every Christmas. The original size ones. They're these
that's
like
you're supposed to have like one of those a week.
Yeah, and
as
also,
a treat.
And also, they were like, yeah, it's got herbs and tinctures. It's doctors love it.
Yeah. And then in the 90s, they were like, fuck it, it's the big slam. It's, 30 ounces of, the standard is 20 ounces now.
Yeah.
Oh, the big slam was a liter. It was the Shaq-sized Pepsi I was drinking that as a child.
Yeah, no, just blah, 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 blah. It's wild.
It's insane. Anyways, here's the New York Times with more on the latest case.
A Florida man died after drinking 3 servings, of a heavily caffeinated beverage from Panera Bread, according to a lawsuit filed against the company on Monday. It is the second lawsuit linking the beverage, charged lemonade, to a death. Dennis Brown, 46, died in October after suffering a cardiac event while walking home from a Panera Bread in Fleming Island, Florida, according to the wrongful death lawsuit, which was filed by Mr. Brown's mother, sister, and brother in Superior Court in Delaware. In a statement on Tuesday, Panera said it stands firmly by the safety of our products. Panera expresses our deep sympathy for Mr. Brown's family, the statement said. Based on our investigation, we believe his unfortunate passing was not caused by one of the company's products. We view this lawsuit, which was filed by the same law firm as a previous claim, to be equally without merit. On October 9th, Brown ordered the charged lemonade and had 2 refills before walking home, the complaint said. During the walk, he suffered a cardiac event and was found unresponsive on a sidewalk where he was pronounced dead. The complaint said that at the Panera, the charged lemonade was offered side by side with drinks with no caffeine or less caffeine, and that it was not advertised as an energy drink and did not have any warnings. The lawsuit does not say whether Mr. Brown ordered a regular or large size.
If he ordered the large, like the previous victim, that would be the equivalent of drinking 9 Red Bulls back to back and then going for a walk.
Yeah. Presenting to the emergency room. This man drank 9 Red Bulls. Here's what happened to his life.
Don't add alcohol to this drink. Oh my God.
No, you will die.
Operating on a level previously only known to millennials the early aughts.
Your heart will invent like a new beat for drill rappers to use in their songs. Don't do it.
We had 4 Loko, which is completely different from the neutered 4 Loko that they have
now.
Yeah,
you call
that
4
Loko.
You
have no idea. I think Buzzballs might come close these days. But what was the other one? There was like an orange one back then.
Oh,
Sparks.
Sparks, yeah.
Insane.
I never had either of them. I think I had like a sip of one. I was like, this is the most disgusting thing I've ever tried.
Yeah.
Fuck you. Also, everyone I know who's had one of these like blacked out immediately and then was awake somehow still for like 6 more hours.
Zombie mode.
And like got into a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
I'm not looking for, to get into that.
But the best take on this, this was before like it really took off, was Luke O'Neill, who implies the reader should zoom out a bit and fully take in all of the crazy shit that's happening in the world right now, and adds an entire lemonade that kills you subplot going on in the background.
Yeah, it's we don't need this right now.
No. Others injected some humor into this otherwise morbid and dystopian subplot with posts like, they should add the Panera lemonade that kills you to these, with a photo of the Coca-Cola remix dispensers.
Oh, no.
An image from Walk Hard with Tim Meadows holding the drink and saying, it's called the lemonade that kills you, Dewey. You don't want none of this shit.
What does it do?
It kills you. A reference to the M. Night Shyamalan movie, Old, featuring the drink which reads, I'm at the beach that makes you old, drinking the lemonade that kills you. And of course, the viral image of Yeonmi Park on a podcast, but this time she's saying, in America, they have a lemonade that kills you.
My favorite one was Ice-T from, Law & Order? He's like, they lure you, they're luring in the teens with the soups and salads, and that's how they get you hooked on the lemonade that kills you.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever made it did a better job than me. Anyway, folks, maybe it's best to just avoid the lemonade that kills you. Don't do it for the meme. We saw what happened to Trevor Jacob when he did something for the meme.
Yeah,
he's in prison.
Yeah.
You could die.
Mm-hmm.
But let's move over to updates on some of this show's favorite criminals, and I'd say other people whose clout chasing ultimately did them in.
Mm-hmm.
Was their fatal flaw, was their thirst for clout. We're talking about Jacob Wohl, Martin Scorsese, and a late-breaking update on old Hunter Biden. And let's just get that one out of the way real quick, because it was announced right before we started filming Thursday evening. Hunter Biden has been indicted on tax charges.
Yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we got him. The 56-page court filing laid out a series of charges, including allegations that the president's son failed to pay taxes, failed to file, evaded an assessment, and filed a fraudulent form. The indictment alleges that rather than pay his taxes, the defendant spent millions of dollars on an extravagant lifestyle. Between 2016 and October 15th, 2020, the defendant spent his money on drugs, escorts and girlfriends, luxury hotels and rental properties, exotic cars, clothing, and other items of a personal nature. In short, everything but his taxes. Yeah, the indictment said. The charges, which include six misdemeanor tax offenses, were brought by special counsel David Weiss. The case was assigned to Judge Mark Scarsi, who was appointed by former President Donald Trump. So, I mean, we got him. Obviously, this is going to ruin Hunter Biden's presidency and severely hinder his chances at being elected. Oh, I'm just learning this for the first time. I'm getting word that Hunter Biden is not the president.
Oh.
He's actually the president's adult son.
Oh, okay.
His large adult son.
Well, then I have a pitch. Remember that old Paris Hilton and what's her name?
The Simple Life.
Yeah. Nicole Richie.
Yeah.
The Simple Life with Hunter Biden and George Santos.
Hell yeah, that's a great idea.
Mm-hmm. We can see them down on the farm milking cows.
Yeah, you know, you got to touch some cow shit sometimes. You got to touch grass.
And I know just the guy, Devin Nunes.
Oh yeah, he's got a big old farm.
Yeah.
He's making that California cheese.
Reality TV is back, folks, if you want it. But like we said, we have updates on two other weirdos for you today, and let's start with Jacob Wall, because just a few episodes ago, we were talking about how we hadn't heard a peep from old Jacob Wall in quite a while, which meant he was either already incarcerated somewhere, who knows, or he was actually so terrified of being locked up that he finally took his lawyer's advice and simply shut the fuck up.
It took a while, but they figured it out.
Our last update regarding Wall came as a result of his collaboration with Jack Berkman for unlawful robocalls that attempted to suppress votes in the 2020 election. And that case resulted in a $5.1 million fine for the duo, and, well, we hadn't heard much from them since. Until this week, when court documents made their way online indicating that Jacob Wall pled guilty to multiple felony counts of securities fraud.
Yeah, this is so funny when I saw this come up because this is a plot.
These are the charges that happened half a decade or more than half a decade ago.
Yeah, very long ago. And yeah, this is like a plot line that sort of like went dead.
Yeah.
Sort of forgot about it. It's like, oh yeah, wait. Oh, he did a whole bunch of other crimes way back then.
Yeah. These are those crimes.
So yeah, the plea was entered into the court record a few days ago on December 4th, and a sentencing date of January 26th, 2024 was added. According to the documents, he pled guilty to selling false securities, false statements, attempted grand theft, and willfully attempting to defraud someone. And these all stem from when he was arrested all the way back in 2016, which is wild when you consider all the illegal activities and just general shenanigans that he's been up to in the years since he was first charged with these crimes.
Basically,
this all happened before we even knew who he was. This was the prequel.
Everything we know and have followed about Jacob Wall happened after this.
Wild.
Yeah. But speaking of people who have been doing crime since we started doing this show, basically, yet another member of the Rogues Gallery is back in the news again because Martin Shkreli might have actually violated his parole in the dumbest way possible by traveling out of state in order to appear on Tucker Carlson's Twitter show. Nobody does it like Martin Shkreli. Here's CNBC.
Infamous pharma bro Martin Shkreli violated his prison release conditions to appear on former Fox News host Tucker Carlson's show on X, a court document showed Wednesday. Shkreli, 40, failed to tell his probation officer that he was leaving his home in Queens, New York for an in-person interview with Carlson in Maine, the officer wrote to a judge in federal court in Brooklyn. Notably, at no time did Shkreli advise the undersigned officer, nor any other officer within the probation department, of his desire to travel out of state to participate in an interview, the officer wrote. Yeah. Seems like a pretty slam dunk case. We got it on video. It all happens on X.
True.
Parole violations.
Yeah.
Yeah, so unfortunately, the officer is requesting the court take no action on Shkreli, citing his otherwise positive adjustment, which is kind of fucked up. Considering how badly these kinds of violations can ruin a normal person's life.
Yeah, they're used against people all the time.
These parole violations seem to be enforced very selectively.
Mm-hmm. The reporting adds that in his November 6th appearance on Carlson's show, Shkreli mused on various topics related to his time in prison, upbringing, and prior business dealings, the U.S. probation officer wrote in Wednesday's court filing. An officer became aware of the interview a day later, and the following week confronted Shkreli about
it. Hey man, what the fuck?
You're making me look bad. Shkreli confirmed the studio was in Maine and that he had traveled there by plane and train, according to the filing. He continued to explain that his leaving the judicial district without permission was a reaction to the perception that his previous supervising probation officer was often non-responsive to his requests for travel, the officer wrote.
Yeah, I just figured you wouldn't get back to me on time, so I just did it anyway. Yeah.
Again, just because your supervising officer was non-responsive doesn't mean you can violate the terms of your release. But that's what he did, and he's almost certainly not going to receive any punishment for it. And if this had been just your average person who, I don't know, had gone to jail for a stint for drug possession or something, they'd be thrown back in prison.
Yeah. And
for doing this.
And remember, he got out like 2 years early for good behavior, but part of that deal is you're on probation.
Yeah.
For the
rest of that sentence.
Come on, man. It's all crime and sentences today, folks, and this next story is no different. Although it involves one of those rare punishments that forces the perpetrator to put themselves in the shoes of the person they wronged. A 39-year-old Karen named Rosemary Hain assaulted a Chipotle employee with a bowl of food a few months back and pleaded guilty to a misdemeanor. The judge presiding over the case gave the woman two options for sentencing. 90 days in jail, or, let's check the mystery box, 30 days in jail with an additional 60 days working in a fast food job. She chose the shorter stay and the fast food job, which is awesome, but we can only imagine that this woman is going to be just absolutely insufferable to those around her by the end of the 60 days, or honestly, at the beginning.
I mean,
when you work in this kind of retail operation, there is, if someone's not pulling their weight, it's real fucking annoying.
This might be the hardest this woman will have to work. I don't know her background, but fast food work is not easy.
No, it's not.
Yeah. It's physically and mentally exhausting many times, and in some cases, you get people throwing food in your face.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's a thankless job.
Yeah.
It really wears you down. I just feel bad for everyone who is going to be forced to work with her.
I mean, don't get me wrong. Maybe at the start of this gig, she would be hopefully super empathetic and cool for the first couple of shifts. Like, hey, look, yeah, I was a bad person. I learned my lesson. I'm here to learn.
Is she working at the same Chipotle where she attacked
That wasn't indicated. She hasn't been able to find a job yet. Nobody wants to hire anymore.
Yeah, this is a weird thing for a judge to be like, this is your sentence. And
go find a job
she's
for
like,
60 days.
Like, okay, your resume is pretty interesting. Why do you want to work in fast food right now? It's like, okay, well, actually I assaulted a fast food worker and I'm being forced to find a fast food job as part of my sentence.
Also, I know employers love this, but I'm only going to be here for 60 days. So all the training that you're going to do to get me up to speed to be a competent and well-performing employee, just throw that away. Because in 60 days, I'm fucking gone.
Yeah, why would any restaurant agree to this unless the court should allocate some of the money that would have gone to paying for 60 days in jail, which is probably a lot of money, and give that to whoever hires her. Because otherwise, why the fuck would they hire her? This is stupid.
Look, maybe the first couple shifts, she's like, I'm learning my lesson and I'm putting myself in everyone's shoes and you know what? I'm going to make a real good go of it. But as time wears on, there's no way that her true colors won't come out.
Oh, I give it like 7 days before she goes back to the judge and she's like, look,
I'll go to jail.
No, she said even worse. She's like, I got something big for you. You take time off of my sentence and I'm gonna give you something so good. After the shift, some of my coworkers go out and smoke weed in the parking lot.
She narcs on all of them. And they're fucking.
Yeah.
Mm. In turn, this woman's punishment could turn into further punishment for local fast food workers.
Yeah, this is not fair.
They have to be around her.
Like, this judge, like this woman, does not understand that this is only going to make
this is like
worse.
Undercover boss, except you don't get a reward from the CEO at the end, and your life is just much worse off.
Yeah, this will actually lead to more crime.
Yeah. Here's CNN with more on this story.
Videos of the woman, Rosemary Hain, berating Chipotle worker Emily Russell on September 5th and then throwing the food in her face at close range went viral after the incident. Hain, a 39-year-old mother of four, pleaded guilty to a misdemeanor assault charge and received the sentence last week in the Parma, Ohio Municipal Court. Do you want to walk in her shoes for 2 months and learn how people should treat people, or do you want to do your jail time?
Elliot's literally doing the King of the Hill judge, which it mirrors this story.
Gilligan asked Hain at the hearing. I'd like to walk in her shoes, Hain responded. Hain has yet to find the job, Gilligan and her attorney told CNN on Wednesday.
oh, you like throwing food around at Chipotle so much. Well, for the next 90 days, you're going to be spending every minute inside of Chipotle. So, yeah, here's the other problem with this, though. It's such a public case. It might result in crowds showing up to whatever establishment hires her in order to berate her and throw food at her. It's bizarre to think about. And there are so many ways for this to go wrong, which is typically why judges usually just go for the standard, I don't know, monetary fine and jail sentence and not this type of eye for an eye justice.
Yeah.
Just put her in the stocks. Let everyone throw their rotting vegetables at her instead. It is a you know, people say, oh, it's cruel and unusual to put someone in the public stocks. But, like, honestly, a lot of crimes would probably be better served with that as a punishment instead of throwing someone in, making them go to jail.
And like, with everyone composting these days, you just show up with your compost bin for all the vegetables.
Yeah.
No waste.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And honestly, maybe not even... We don't even need to use vegetables. Just put someone in the stocks in public. Public humiliation, it needs to come back.
Public shaming. Yeah.
Sometimes when the judges do this kind of stuff, they just make someone walk around with like a sandwich board sign saying like, I'm a fucking idiot. I shoplifted from this store. Laugh at me. And like, that's the kind of special sentence I can get behind. What this judge is trying to do with the Chipotle Karen, there's too much to it.
Yeah.
It's too complicated.
Goes too deep.
It involves
too many
people.
You're punishing everyone around this woman,
yeah,
too. Yeah. Anyways, finally today we have two stories regarding the downfall of tech and entertainment companies. And both of these stories are extra frustrating because it really appears as though no one is safe from the very stupid whims of platforms and their leadership, no matter how big and successful you are. No amount of viewership, talent, or accolades are enough to protect some shows from being canceled, or, in our first story, an entire country being shut out of the service. Twitch is shutting down Twitch in South Korea entirely.
Oh, well, does South Korea play video games?
Nope.
Are games popular there?
Nope.
Oh, so that's the problem.
Placing the blame entirely on local internet operators for charging too much for them to operate. And this also comes after Twitch already reduced the streaming quality in South Korea a few months back in order to save money. So they're like, everyone, you can only, max is like 720, and we're all good, right? We still get all of the views and traffic from operating in South Korea. You guys get to broadcast and create content for us. It's a sweetheart deal. We're going to have to go ahead and black out the entire country. We're sorry. Here's the Associated Press with more.
In a blog post announcing the company's plan this week, Dan Clancy said the network fees the company has been paying to South Korean internet operators were 10 times more than in most other markets. He did not provide specific numbers to back such claims. Yeah, I'm a bit skeptical of that.
Yeah.
We've made the difficult decision to shut down the Twitch business in Korea on February 27th, 2024, Clancy said in the post. Twitch was able to lower costs by limiting video quality, he said, but our network fees in Korea are still 10 times more expensive than in most other countries. The move drew vehement complaints from South Korean users and are thought to have encouraged many to switch to other services like YouTube or South Korean streaming sites like Afrika TV. The planned withdrawal from South Korea is the latest sign of business struggles at Twitch, which announced in March that it was laying off 400 employees, saying that its user and revenue growth has not kept pace with our expectations. Twitch has been operating in Korea at a significant loss, and unfortunately, there is no pathway forward for our business to run more sustainably in that country, Clancy wrote in his blog post.
Reminder that Twitch is owned by Amazon, the biggest country in their
they
company.
They are,
in the world.
And they've, to my knowledge, they've never made money. Like, I mean, just look at what the business is. It requires so much overhead costs in hosting that there's just no way to make it profitable. Yeah. Anywhere. So a lot of people are saying like, oh, this might be a sign that Amazon's like finally tired of this Twitch thing. This happens with a lot of companies. They get into gaming and after a while they're like, what the fuck are we doing?
We can't sell this.
I mean,
people are saying the N-word.
Even Microsoft, a gaming company, gave up.
They ripped the Band-Aid early. They were like, this is going nowhere.
They quickly, very quickly, they're just like, this is just a money pit. Yeah. We're losing money on every stream.
Well, back here in the States, Spotify is proving that even if you have an award-winning show on a platform that's actually profitable, despite exploiting its artists, that is still not good enough because Spotify has removed large swaths of podcasts that it brought in over the past few years in order to compete in the massive podcasting market. And one of the podcasts that was canceled had recently won a Pulitzer Prize. And this has led many creators in the industry to wonder, what exactly do you want from us? With more on this and the rest of Spotify's recent issues, here's The Verge. The dust is still settling on Spotify's latest round of layoffs. On Monday, Spotify announced it was cutting 17% of its workforce, or approximately 1,500 employees, as a means of making the company even more efficient. This round of layoffs dwarfs the past two this year, with the company cutting about 600 employees in January and another 200 employees, mostly from podcasting, in June.
They add that such steep cuts are shocking when the economy is growing and the company is turning a profit. Unlike so many other layoff announcements, this one did not spend a whole lot of time dwelling on macroeconomic factors. Instead, it is an unambiguous attempt at appeasing investors. Ah, we love our investors, don't we, folks? Fuck everyone else. Mm-hmm. Let's get these investors paid. If Spotify was ever serious about making in-depth narrative podcasts, it certainly isn't now. Among its many cuts, the company has decided to cancel Heavyweight after it wraps up its current season. It is one of Gimlet's flagship podcasts and a beloved show among people in the industry. It is also cutting investigative podcast Stolen, which Gimlet launched in 2021, and went on to earn the Pulitzer Prize in Audio Reporting and a Peabody Award for it this year.
We got a Pulitzer and a Peabody. Oh, well, good for you.
Wow. Let's have a look at your budget, Spotify. So there's a line item here that says you gave someone named Joe Rogan like
$100 million. Yeah.
Could that perhaps be contributing to your deficiencies elsewhere? I guess
probably nothing.
Whatever. Fire everyone else. Keep Joe Rogan around.
Uh-huh.
It's such an evil company.
Yeah, all around.
It really is.
That's why, like, not that other companies aren't evil, but yeah, it's one of the main reasons why I made the switch to Apple Music entirely.
The entire landscape, particularly with music, is terrible, but Spotify is the worst symptom of it. And it is wild that podcasting has now, they've figured out a way to fuck that up too, which is like, podcasting is the ideal, honestly, independent media medium,
yeah,
because anyone can publish anywhere. It's all like kind of open source. And
comparatively, not that it's cheap, but comparatively a lower overhead than most other productions.
I mean, it sounds like I haven't listened to these two shows that got canceled.
They're probably very well produced.
Yeah, they're probably, you know,
well-researched.
Gimlet and like, yeah, these investigative shows, they are, you know, a lot of researchers, producers and stuff like that. They cost money, but it's like,
it's not like an HBO Films documentary or something.
Yeah, it seems like it would be pretty easy to balance that budget, or, you know, if you just want to be taken seriously as a media brand, you keep that around even though you're losing money because you're winning fucking Pulitzer Prizes.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Like, even if this is a loss leader, you keep it around because it makes your overall operation look good.
Yeah, no, it's always so annoying when companies don't get that. Mm-hmm. They just see it as a line item. Like, why do I own this?
Yeah. And this, of course, comes after the company dumped around $1 billion into podcasting over the past few years. And as Elliot pointed out, that would be most notably signing Joe Rogan for what was reported to be around $100 million.
Can someone who's good at the economy tell me how to fix this?
Fuck. Anyways, yeah, that's News Dump for this week. We'll be back for Weekly Weird News very soon. Surprise, we've been swindled by Mr. George Anthony DeVolder-Santa.
It happened to me.
He still has time. He still has until Monday, I believe, to fulfill our obligations of creating a video. But at this point, who even cares?
He took our money. He went to Miami. He's having a blast.
Yeah, he was dragging those suitcases with dollar bills flying out. But, you know, at the very least, it does feel good to be part of the cultural zeitgeist in knowing that we, too, were taken advantage of by George Anthony DeVolder.
We're now part of the story.
Even more so than if he had actually done the video.
Yeah. We'll put us on the Wikipedia.
Yeah. Anyways, if you want to know more about George Santos's latest antics, or you want to watch our most recent episode of Tech News Day about the dumbest AI news you've ever heard and the most incendiary Elon Musk shit you've ever heard, all in one video, we've got them for you popping up in just a second. But before they do, you got to earn it.
You know what to do.
You got
to
like the
video. Number one, like it.
Number two, leave a comment or reply to a comment.
Engagement.
Number three, subscribe to the channel if you're not already for some reason. Number four, optional. Click the join button.
Number five, not optional. Press the bell so you know when we upload.
Also, yeah, this video isn't sponsored, so click the join button.
Oh, yeah.
Now the videos are up there. Watch those. We'll be back soon for Weekly Weird News.
Bye.
Bye-bye.